get you if she's able. And you know the Queen of Hearts is always your best bet. Now it seems to me some fine things have been laid upon your table, but you only want the ones that you can't get. Desperado, oh, you ain't getting no younger. Your pain and your hunger are driving you home. And freedom, oh, freedom, well, that's just some people talking. Your prison is walking through this world all alone. Don't you peek it cold in the wintertime? The sky won't snow and the sun won't shine. It's hard to tell the nighttime from the day.
Sitting pretty good, high on a hill, looking at a field downwind. If I can make a nickel off of turning in bass, never worry about the price of gas. I'll be wheeling and dealing and sitting there reeling them in. Hunting, fishing, loving every day. That's the prayer that a country boy prays. Thank God he made me this way. Hunting and fishing and loving every day. Early in the morning, late in the evening, I'm getting red dirt rich and Flint River paid. Hunting, fishing and loving every day. I get a little farm pond buzz, sound of gravel when I'm back. Get up, pulling a string on a 9.92 stroke Mercury. I love it when my baby wants to roll with me. Throws her boots on, climbs in a tree, tucking her hair in my hat, and she's ready to go. And we get to hunting, fishing, loving every day. That's the prayer that a country boy prays. Thank God he made me this. And loving every day. Early in the morning, late in the evening, I'm getting red dirt rich and Flint River paid. Hunting, fishing, and loving every day. Yeah. So while y'all are up there
breathing in that old dirty air, I'll be down here, knee deep in the muck of lake. Every day I want to see them tall pines sway. Y'all close them eyes, let's go there in our mind. A hunting and fishing and loving every day, that's the prayer this country boy prays. Thank God he made me this way. Hunting and fishing and loving every day, black coffee in the morning, dark whiskey in the evening, hiking red dirt rich and forever paid. Hunting and fishing and loving every day. Woo! Come on. Won't you come along with me? Won't you come along with me? I know you want to see. Hunting, fishing, and loving every day.
Read a couple of verses from one of my favorite passages, 2 Corinthians chapter 5. For if we know that if this earthly tent we live in is destroyed, he's talking about our body, we know if this earthly tent is destroyed, we have a building from God, an eternal house in heaven, not built by human hands. Meanwhile, we groan, longing to be clothed our heavenly dwelling, because we know when we're clothed, we will not be found naked. For while we are in this tent, we groan and are burdened, and do not wish to be unclothed, but to be clothed with our heavenly dwelling, so that what is mortal may be swallowed up by life. I just love that passage. What is mortal? That's what we're at right now. Swallowed up by life. Life is yet to come for us. Then he goes on in verse 6. Therefore we are always confident and know that as long as we are at home in this body, we are away from the Lord. We live by faith, not by sight. We're confident, I say, and would prefer to be away from the body and at home with the Lord. So we make it our goal to please him, whether we're at home, in the body, or away from it. Join me as we pray. Today, our Father, we come. We come to celebrate the life of Mike Roper. And Father, today, in the midst of our grief, would you give us joy? In the midst of our sorrow, would you give us hope? Father, your son came to heal the brokenhearted, and today we claim that promise that you would heal the broken hearts that are here today. Today, may your presence give us comfort and peace, and may your strength sustain us. Father, we pray that your loving arms would wrap around us and keep us close to you, and Lord, that you would lighten the burdens of the grief and sorrow that's in our hearts today. And Father, now we pray as your Son taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, for thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Lazy yellow moon coming up tonight, shining through the trees. Crickets are singing and lightning bugs are floating on the breeze. Baby, get ready. Across the field where the creek turns back by the old stumble road, I'm gonna take you to a special place that nobody knows. Baby, get ready. Ooh, ooh. You and me going fishing in the dark, lying on our backs and counting the stars where the cool grass grows. Down by the river in the full moonlight, we'll be falling in love in the middle of the night, just moving slow. Summer's come and the days are getting long.
Mike Roper, 78 of Erie, peacefully passed away at 9:40 a.m. Sunday, November 21st, 2021, at his home. He was born in August 23, 1943, in Lawrence, Kansas, to Georgia Radakovich. Mike was raised, I'll give anybody an opportunity to play, is that right? Mike was raised by his grandmother, Gladys Foles, and grew up in Parsons and Dennis area, where he attended country schools. Mike left Kansas at a young age, and moved to Colorado, where he worked in a chrome plating, along with many other adventures. He then lived in Tucson, Arizona, where he worked in the copper mines. He later moved to Erie, where he worked as a butcher and meat cutter in several surrounding towns before becoming a manager at various Horton's Pizza restaurants in the area. Mike loved to mow and help others in the community whenever possible. He enjoyed hunting and fishing, especially catfish, as you kind of witnessed by those pictures there. He competed in coon hunting competitions in Kansas, Missouri, Arkansas, and Oklahoma. He also enjoyed searching for and collecting arrowheads, woodworking, and making knives. He and Diana Pierce were united in marriage on March 31st, 1996, in Miami, Oklahoma. He was a devoted husband who loved Diana with all his heart. Mike was a special friend of many, a genuine, one-of-a-kind individual. I would 100% agree with that. Who would tell it like it was and never lacked anything witty to say. Survivors include his wife, Diana, of the home, children, David Walker, Kim Roper, Georgia Roper, and Ashley Marie. He was preceded in death by his mother, grandmother, brother, Clyde, two sons, Michael and Danny, daughter, Tammy, grandson, Dalton, and recently his beloved dog, Buddy, who he loved very much. So that kind of tells you a little bit about what Mike did in his life. Now I'm going to tell you a little bit about who Mike really was. I've been Mike's neighbor for a lot of years, myself, my wife, Gail, and I, and have had a great, fun relationship with the Ropers, living next door to him. And the one thing I always noticed was he was an extremely devoted husband, and him and Diana had more fun together. It was just, most Saturday mornings, you'd see them getting up, taking off to go hunting and fishing or go do something. They were like a couple little kids. You know, they're always kind of giddy. And I was like, wow, that is, but they really appreciated and took care of each other very much. And that's a very unique thing to see in the world today. And to see that level of devotion that they never lost, it was just kind of a fun thing to watch. Mike was also a lover of animals, and over the time, Mike and Diana had birds, a pet rat, Burmese pythons, boa constrictors, Himalayan Persians, and of course, dogs. They had a lot of dogs. Mike was someone who enjoyed the outdoors, as we said earlier, and probably loved hunting and fishing more than anybody I ever met, except maybe Diana. I don't know. So they were both kind of a tie on that one. But that was a lot of his life, and one thing I always admired about Mike is, you know, there's always kind of the playbook of life that you do, that you, if you go to college and you do this and all, and that's fine if that's what you want, but if it isn't what you want, what do? You know, and Mike always did what was in his heart and what he wanted to do, and he had a great life. He enjoyed it. He wanted to work hard. He wanted to hunt and fish. Money wasn't a big motivator for him. It was more about how he spent his time on earth, and that's kind of a lesson all of us could learn. You know, one thing with Mike as a hunter, he was a great shot, and Diana told me a story of, he had amazing eyesight too, I'll tell you that, because for somebody that had to start wearing glasses and it didn't make me very happy, and to see a guy much older than me that could still tie fishing line without glasses and stuff, it was like, yeah, that's not very fair, but he could, and he had a great eyesight, and he had a steady hand, and there was a time he dropped a running doe at 600 yards using a regular 25-06 and a standard scope, and for anybody that hunts, that's quite an amazing feat. It would have been better if he'd had a bow, but it's still a pretty good story. So, but if you're here today, you're probably someone that Mike led into his life, and that wasn't a lot of people. It's kind of an exclusive club, and it's kind of a compliment to the type of person that you are. As Diana related to me, she said, you know, Mike liked to show a rough exterior, but he was a loving teddy bear inside. And I would agree with that. Once you got past that, that's why he didn't let a lot of people in, because he was pretty vulnerable once you did. She went on to say that over the past 10 to 12 years, he let several people in his life, and in doing so, was able to experience being loved by many wonderful friends. And Mike related that to me. I was down visiting one day, and he said, you know, if I hadn't found Christ, I probably never would have opened my heart to people, and I've never really had close friends. And over the last 10 or 12 years, I've really had an opportunity to have those type of relations and see how wonderful they are. And one of them was a lady that's also a very close friend of mine that I admire very much. And Twyla Dillinger was pretty special to Mike. They would go out and he would mow for her, and then they'd sit on his trailer and have some deep conversations, which I'm not privy to know what they were, but Mike sure enjoyed them, and it had a positive impact on his life. She had a positive impact on my life as well, Twyla, so you're a great person. He always said that Twyla was his favorite girl. And Diana said that was, of course, excluding her. But anyway, so he held you in extremely high regard. As I said with Mike, he didn't let a lot of people in, and it was a pretty exclusive club. And, you know, kind of looking around the room today, I'm really surprised some of you made the cut, but his heart must have really really softened as he went on. But, you know, once you became a friend of Mike's, he was a true friend. And that's what I always try to call with my people is, he was one of those through thick and thin, and if he told you he'd do something, he would do it. He also expected that same thing for you. And one way to no longer be a friend with Mike was to disappoint him, to make a commitment to him, and then let him down. You probably didn't get a second chance. He had to really like you to get a second chance. But this quality in Mike made Diana feel safe, protected, and loved. So much so that the age difference between them was just not the issue for her that it was for Mike early on. In fact, Diana said he tried to dodge her in the beginning, but she hooked him by explaining that even if he lived 2 years, she'd rather spend that time with him than without him. And getting to know Diana over the years, as persistent as she is, that story does not shock me a bit. So that was she had her sights set and went after it. So, but God did bless them with 27 years. Sometimes crazy, but always wonderful years. And as I say, as a neighbor, I witnessed the true joy that they lived their life with. And you just don't see that very often. Steve Smith and I were talking yesterday on the phone, and I said, you know, the only thing that comes to my mind is it was a true love story. You know, you just don't see them very often. But those two never, I mean, they always treated each other right. They didn't always agree and all that type of stuff, but that the loyalty and the love was always there. As Diana tells it, they lived their early years living on the edge without a care in the world, you know, always pushing the limits, and but through the grace of God, they made it through it with little consequence. But then in 2007, like many of you who live in Erie, what happened? We had a flood. We had a devastating flood. And there was people that lost their homes, or they knew people that lost their homes. And I think everybody sitting in this church, if you live in Erie, probably were affected by a family member, or you went out and helped them. And it was a big deal, and it really showed me what a great community this was, because everybody kicked in and nobody really was put out in the cold. But it also kind of makes you think, all, you know, we go along in life and, you know, we got our staff and we got our jobs, we feel pretty secure and everything, and then one day the world shows you that you have no power whatsoever. It can take everything away from you in an evening. And that's exactly what happened to the Ropers. They lost everything. Their house flooded. They were done. They had to start their whole life over again. They had to buy another house. They had to start that whole process. And I think that revelation kind of set the stage for what happened next with Mike. As in the Old Testament, Joseph says, what was meant for evil, God used for good. And this tragic event changed Mike and Diana's Roper's life forever. Mike met a preacher from the First Christian Church and saw something that was more certain than the fragile world that we just talked about. He learned that there was something else out there that you could count on. So he wanted to start attending the First Christian Church in Erie, and Diana said she knew that if she didn't go, he wouldn't go, because they did everything together. So they started attending church, and that kind of started their Christian walk in life. And as usual, they did it as a team. So they started going down the road. And then Diana shared with me kind of an interesting story. I think it's something, if somebody that believes in Christ, that you kind of wish happened to you. You know, you always want that absolute, that miracle thing. But one morning, he walked in the room where she was, and he looked like he had seen a ghost. He asked her to sit down and related something that was happening to him. He told her, I prayed the prayer with Dr. Charles Stanley. It was a TV minister that he really enjoyed. He mentioned to me several times, and something happened. I feel weird, and something has changed inside me. It scared him because he didn't know what had overcome him. She explained to him that he had, in fact, had seen a ghost, the Holy Ghost, and that the Holy Spirit can fill us as though he is flooding your whole being with some awesome presence. Then that he was now saved, and God had forgiven him. And that was a concept that as he drew closer to the end, Mike really struggled with. You know, we had a lot of conversations about it. And the more forgiving and loving his nature became towards others, the more God softened his heart. And then he started seeing things he didn't see before. You know, and I think all of us that have lived a few years never saw the wrong in what we did until we have a different lens to look at it through. And then all of a sudden it really convicts us. So there was guilt that was probably 20 or 30 years overdue that showed up nonetheless. And Mike really struggled with, how can God be so good to forgive me? I can't forgive myself for what I did. You know, and we had a conversation about it. And one of the things I tried to impress on him was that it was a journey. And the only way he would have offended God was not staying on that journey. You know, we've all, depending on our story and where we came from, all have different paths that we walked, and that really influences our view of the world. And his view of the world didn't start out great. You know, it wasn't the best. So, but instead of just staying there, over the time, he kept progressing and progressing and progressing until the end. I have absolutely no doubt that Mike's name is written in the book of life, and that we will see him all again one day. So that's kind of the story of Mike Roper. You know, he started walking a rough road, and he ended life loved fiercely by a good woman, surrounded by many true friends, and of course, Buddy, the dog that loved him with all his heart. He loved him back. And I think he even took a spin on the mower a couple weeks before he actually passed away, which is something he really loved doing. So, you know, It was just kind of a great end. It always reminds me kind of like a Dickens novel, you know, that starts with a rough and tumble beginning but ends in a triumphant love story. And Mike was a happy man when he passed away. And that's saying a lot. I asked him when we were kind of talking about me doing his eulogy, which, by the way, I'm totally uncomfortable with, but I did it for Mike. So, but I said, what would you, you know, what would you like to say to everybody that's been in your life and means something to you? And he kind of grinned that grin, if you knew Mike very well, that he always had. And he said, well, you can tell them, they can all kiss. And then he kind of stopped and smiled. You know, I thought about not sharing that one, but that was kind of classic Roper, and he was a fun guy, you know, and so it was really good. So you will be missed, my friend. And I now invite anybody out here that would like to share a story that they have. Wayne's got a microphone, so he can come by, and anybody else would like to share anything? Or do I have to request?
This story is truly a love story. Each time I would visit, a good deal of the conversation would center around Diana and his love and concern for her, especially after he was no longer there. I told him that there was a whole big family of people that would take good care of her. It has occurred to me since that if there is one thing this church has, it is a group of ladies who have had to walk down the road you are beginning, Diana. I know you will have some wonderful people walking beside you. Second, Mike was genuine. You always knew where you stood with Mike. He had seen enough of life to recognize most people for who they were, and he wasn't afraid to tell you what he thought. And third, like Steve, I occasionally heard Mike's concerns over things of the past. Once I told him that he gave the rest of us far more credit for the good life than we deserved. There's not a one of us that don't have thoughts, words, and actions we regret. Sometimes we're perhaps better at masking the past. Be that as it may, I think Mike looked with wonderment that he was a child of a God who put all the past behind us. God's grace and his son Jesus has made it possible for all of us to know the security of knowing that the past is just that, the past. That knowledge brought Mike peace.
I didn't get to know Mike till they came to church here, and I didn't even know Diana very well, but he's let me into his home, he fed me, he mowed my yard, he repaired my mower, and every Sunday he would hand me a peppermint to get me through church. And he's the only person in Erie, Kansas that ever called me Susie, and I don't know why. But he will truly be missed, and we loved you both, Diana.
Anybody else? Going once, going twice.
Well, has anyone seen what a flathead looks like, fish? They're kind of freaky looking, kind of, I don't know, prehistoric. So I do remember the first time that we went fishing on the boat and he caught a flathead and reeled it up to the boat. It's dark, but you can see the moon, you know, like the song. And I have the net to put it in and it come up and, I mean, horrified me. I screamed and jumped back, and luckily we didn't lose the fish. I was able to get it, but he thought that was just the most funniest thing ever.
Anyone else? Thank you. Thank you.
If I had only known the last time would be the last time, I would have put off all the things I had to do. I would have stayed a little longer, held on a little tighter. Now what I'd give for one more day with you. Cause there's a wound here in my heart where something's missing, and they tell me that it's gonna heal with time. But I know you're in a place where all your wounds have been erased, and knowing yours are healed is healing mine. The only scars in heaven, it won't belong to me and you. There'll be no such thing as broken, and all the old will be made new. And the thought that makes me smile now, even as the tears fall down, is that the only scars in heaven are on the hands that hold you now. I know the road you walked was anything but easy. You picked up your share of scars along the way. Oh, but now you're standing in the sun. You fought your fight and your race is run. The pain is all a million miles away. The only scars in heaven, it won't belong to me and you. There'll be no such thing as broken, and all the old will be made new. And the thought that makes me smile now, even as the tears fall down, is that the only scars in heaven, yeah, are on the hands that hold you now. Not a day goes by that I don't see you. You live on in all the better parts of me. Until I'm standing with you in the sun, I'll fight this fight and this race I'll run. Until I finally see what you can see. Oh, the only scars in heaven, it won't belong to me and you. There'll be no such thing as broken, and all the old will be made new. And the thought that makes me smile now, and even as the tears fall down, that the only scars in heaven are on the hands that hold you now.
Mike's favorite verse was Ephesians chapter 2, verse 8, "For it is by grace that you've been saved through faith, and this not of yourself, it is the gift of God." Now, I've often heard and even said that a text out of context is a pretext, but this is a text that will stand by itself. But having said that, I want to read the context. "But because of his great love for us, God, who is rich in mercy, made us alive with Christ, even when we were dead in transgressions. It is by grace you have been saved. And God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus, in order that in the coming ages we might show the incomparable riches of his grace expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. For it is by his grace you have been saved. Through faith, this not from yourselves, is a gift of God. Not by works, so no one can boast. For we are God's workmanship, created in Christ Jesus to do good works which God prepared in advance for us to do. I think I've often misquoted this verse. I think I've often said it is a gift of God. But the text says it is the gift of God. This is Christmas time. This is when we remember the gift that God gave to us. His Christmas gift, his son. And then I go back through this passage and notice that about five or six times he mentions Christ, that gift. He mentions his great love for us. And I find it interesting that he uses the phrase in verse 4, who is rich in mercy. And then down here in verse 7, his incomparable riches of his grace. Grace and mercy are two sides of the same coin. Mercy is not getting what you deserve. And grace is getting what you don't deserve. Let me explain that. You're driving down the highway much too fast. Some of you are laughing. You may resemble this remark. And you know, the policeman says, stops you, and you're going too fast. Now, the fact that he let you off of the warning ticket, that is mercy. You did not get what you deserved. But while he's at it, he gives you a ticket that is a free lunch. That is grace. He gives you something you did not deserve. God's grace is seen on the cross. Now, I did not know Roper in his BC days before Christ. But I think I can hear some people saying, but he does not deserve grace. And you're right. But then neither do you. Nor I. Because grace, like its twin virtue, forgiveness, is available only to those of us who don't deserve it. If we deserved it, we would not need it. You see, if I think I'm good, grace will not seem good to me. But the more I recognize the ugliness of my sin, the greater is my appreciation for the beauty of God's grace. I love that old hymn, grace, grace, God's grace is greater than what? All my sin. God's grace is always greater no matter what. When God's grace and mercy collide with our shame and our guilt, it's messy, but it's beautiful. Jesus knows everything that you and I have done, and he wants you and I to know that his grace is greater. You see, we're able to receive God's grace if we recognize our need for it and we're willing to accept it. For it is by grace that you've been saved. And that's through faith, not of ourselves. It is the gift of God. Our Father, we thank you for Roper's life. We thank you for the people he touched. We thank you that he was someone for whom you made a difference. We thank you I thank you, Father, even for that struggle that he had of realizing he wasn't worthy, because we all need to go through that struggle ourselves. I thank you he came to know your grace. I pray that each of us here today would know your grace and know that even through this dark valley of the shadow, you're walking with us. You're there for us. You love us. You promise never to leave us nor forsake us. Lord, we cling to you because you're our hope. For it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
These things that are pleasing you can hurt you somehow. Don't you draw the Queen of Diamonds, boy. She'll beat you if she's able. And you know the Queen of Hearts is always your best bet. Now it seems to me some fine things have been laid upon your table, but you only want the ones that you can't get. Desperado, oh, you ain't getting no younger. Your pain and your hunger are driving you home. Freedom, oh, freedom. Well, that's just some people talking. Your prison is walking through this world all alone. Don't you peek it cold in the wintertime? The sky won't snow and the sun won't shine. It's hard to tell the nighttime from the day. And you're losing all your highs and lows. Ain't it funny how the feeling goes away? Desperado, why don't you come to senses, come down from your fences, open the gate. It may be raining, but there's a rainbow above you. You better let some. Before it's too late.
Make a living from walking in the woods. You can bet I'd be sitting pretty good, high on a hill, looking at a field downwind. If I can make a nickel off of turning in bass, never worry about the price of gas. I'd be wheeling and dealing and sitting there reeling them in. Hunting, fishing, loving every day. That's the prayer that a country boy prays. Thank God he made me this way. Hunting and fishing and loving every day. Early in the morning, late in the evening, I'm getting red dirt rich and Flint River paid. Hunting, fishing and loving every day. Gravel when I'm backing up, pulling the string on a 9.9 two-stroke Murphy. I love it when my baby wants to roll with me, throws her boots on, climbs in a tree, tucking her hair in my hat and she's ready to go. And we get to hunting, fishing, loving every day. That's the prayer that a country boy prays. Thank God he made me this way. Loving every day, early in the morning, late in the evening, I'm getting red dirt rich and Flint River paid. Hunting and fishing and loving every day, yeah. So while y'all are up there breathing in that old dirty air, I'll be down here, knee deep in the muck of leaf. Hunting and fishing, loving every day. I want to see them tall pines sway. Y'all close them eyes, let's go there in our mind. Hunting and fishing and loving every day. That's the prayer this country boy prays. Thank God he made me this way. Hunting and fishing and loving every day. Black coffee in the morning, dark whiskey in the evening. I get red dirt rich and Flint River paid. Hunting and fishing and loving every day. Come along with me. Won't you come along with me? I know you want to see. I'm hunting and fishing and loving every day.
Shall I of you every step of the way. And treats you kind,
of all you dreamed of, and I wish you joy and happiness. But above all this, I wish you love. And I will always love you. I will always love you. I will always love you. I will always love you.
Darling,